This video was sponsored by Raycon.
Ugh, death stole my Raycon Everyday E25 wireless earbuds. What am I gonna do?
I have returned.
Oh, that was fast.
It seems you were right about the E25s. They can last up to 6 hours on a charge and up to 24 hours using this convenient charging case. So I am able to listen to gardening podcasts all day.
Well, what did I tell you?
They are more comfortable and lower profile than the other earbuds I have tried.
I agree. The fit's perfect for any ear.
I am impressed by the assortment of fun colors and patterns they come in, the 45-day return policy, and the fact that they are still about half the price of other premium wireless earbuds.
Not sure why you care about that, seeing as you stole mine.
The sound quality is excellent, and the bass is so meaty that I can appreciate every individual wub in my nastiest drops of 2020 Megamix.
Yep, the bass is very meaty.
And when I am listening to my ambient Dreamcore mix...
Yeah?
The drops are too nasty! The bass is too meaty!
Whoa.
Prepare to depart for the underworld!
Whoa. Look, if you're in the mood for less bass, just make a custom EQ setting on your preferred music app. Easy as pie, that's what I do.
Your banishment has been retracted. For now.
Phew. Now, about my... And he's gone. I guess if I'm buying a new pair, I better head to buyraycon.com/Arlo so I can get 15% off. Using my own coupon code. How did it come to this? Oh boy. Hello, my beautiful friends. I'm so glad you're here today. I love you so much. So, in the latest Nintendo News Roundup, it's a show I do on YouTube, if you've never heard of it before. I talked about a few quotes that Nintendo President Furukawa gave recently in interviews. But there is one quote or series of quotes that I left out. And that is because as I was reading them, I very quickly realized that I could easily spend an entire video talking about this one thing. I kept trying to, I'm like, maybe I can fit it in there, maybe just like limit it to like 3 minutes or something. I can't. I have too much to say. So that's why we're here, doing an entire video about this one thing. But that is just a testament to how much I love this. How much I... Oh, I love it. I love it so much. But first, I'm sorry, before we dig into it, a tiny bit of background. You might have noticed that there is a trend in the industry, just the greater video game industry, at least the AAA game industry, not as much the indies, but at least in the AAA industry, great success is followed by great hubris, which leads to great downfall. We see it again and again and again, to the point where an average consumer can look at it and even see it coming and be like, are these companies, the people running these companies, how do they know what they're doing if they're so predictable in these patterns? We see it particularly with PlayStation and Xbox. They trade back and forth every generation. They've done it 3-4 generations now. One does super well. So the next generation, they make a bunch of stupid mistakes because they think that they can do no wrong, and it ends up hurting them a whole lot. And then whoever did poorly, the next time they are humbled and they say, you know what, we really need to do this. We really need to make it work. So the next generation, they're the good ones, and they go back and forth. And we're seeing it again. It's not as pronounced as it has been in the past, but Xbox is doing a whole lot of great stuff, and Sony is just kind of like, triggers. The triggers are cool, I guess. And of course, I would be remiss not to mention how Nintendo did it. Nintendo absolutely did it. They rode so high with the Wii. The Wii made them so much money that eventually they just went, you know what, we don't really need to make games anymore. Like, they were making enough with console sales and with third-party sales. If you don't know, if you are the platform holder, you're Nintendo, every single person that sells software on your system, you get a cut. So eventually, they didn't even need to make any games anymore. They just sat back and raked in the money. And then, of course, the Wii U came along. They said, we're Nintendo. We did the Wii. This is going to be great. It's going to capture the same audience. Whatever. Two screens? Sure, that works. And then it just did not work. It did not work at all. They crashed very hard. So naturally, ever since the Switch became a big success, pretty much right out of the gate, I have been asking myself, is Nintendo gonna do the same thing? Are they gonna let this get to their heads and really mess up next time? And that's why, and I've mentioned it before. I said, hey, the Switch is great, but don't count on the next one being just as good.
they have made mistakes, very big mistakes, because of their own, I don't know, their own hubris. Let's call it hubris. You know, they think they can't do anything wrong, so they just kind of do it, and a thing doesn't work. And is the Switch gonna be the same way? I mean, it almost kind of feels like it's sort of already been happening. You know, the further we go away from launch, Nintendo does seem to be just kind of creeping further and further in the direction of some not so good decisions and such. You know, like, is that because the success is so great? We just don't know. And I hate the idea. I don't want Nintendo to do that. So that is where we now come to the stuff that Furukawa said recently. I'm just gonna dig into it. Let's just read it here. This full article, at least from what I'm getting from it, is available on Kotaku. I'll put the link down in the description. Furukawa says a good number of stuff about just like how the Switch is now in the middle part of its life cycle, and how because it's a handheld, it's kind of a unique opportunity. They can kind of lengthen the life cycle. They're getting longer and longer. There's still a lot of opportunities. But specifically, he was asked about development timeframes for hardware, and he said this: "We are always doing R&D, because you must do all sorts of various preparations to make one new console. The truth is that you cannot stop. Ultimately, the deciding factor as to whether or not something becomes an actual product is whether or not it creates a new experience." You know, most of that's standard, like, we know that we've said it before, R&D is always happening. You know, you can't just snap your fingers and suddenly there's a new thing. You gotta be researching it for probably years ahead of time. But it gets better. "Currently, the Switch's sales are exceedingly favorable and achievements are also good, but I have zero peace of mind. No matter the hits, in the entertainment business, people someday do lose interest. Up until now, we have repeatedly had the experience of our business taking a nosedive. Because of this, I myself, as well as those within the company, do not at all think the current state of affairs will keep going and going. To paraphrase, every single year is a do or die situation. You must give new customers fresh surprises, and our existence can slip into obscurity at any time. I always have this kind of sense of crisis." Dramatic pause. Did you hear all of that? Are you appreciating what he said as much as I am? We don't always get to hear these very candid things from Nintendo. We don't always get to know exactly what's going on deep down inside, what's going on in their noggins, and often what's going on in their noggins is very confusing and weird and really goes against what we want, what we think would be even a good business decision. But that right there, my gosh, that provides me personally at least with a lot of peace of mind. The thing about Furukawa is that people seem to be fairly unsure about him. You know, there was Iwata. He was great. He made some mistakes, but obviously he was great. Then the Switch came out and we had Kimishima for a while. He was the interim president. And during that time, everything was going right. But we don't exactly know how much of that was Kimishima or was it just set up by Iwata. We don't really know the process. All of these things are in development for so long that it's really hard to keep track of who is doing what, who is affecting what. We don't even know exactly what the president does. There seem to be some decisions within the company that are weird, and I feel like a president, someone who's controlling everything, should have had a say in that, but I'm not really sure. And so we don't know about Furukawa. I know a lot of people are, you know, kind of blaming him for a lot of the bad stuff going on in Nintendo. I don't know. Was that all set up by Kimishima and now it's just coming into effect now? Is it all Furukawa? Is it someone else? Who really knows? But despite all that, this is one of the best things I have ever heard a Nintendo executive say. It means that no, they are aware. They are fully aware that they could tank at any time because they didn't. I mean, obviously they might have believed it before, but they weren't really, I mean, come on, like with the Wii U, I'm just beating a dead horse, but they made so many mistakes with the Wii U, so many baffling, tone-deaf mistakes that it's like they weren't really paying attention. It's like they didn't think that they could fail. It's like they could do no wrong. You know, I'm not trying to like insult Nintendo, you know, oh, they're all just a bunch of dunces. They don't know what they're doing, but they do frequently make decisions, you gotta admit, that seem really weird. They seem really weird, and yet he's like, no, like, we get it. We have been through this a number of times. Nintendo has seen some very big highs and some very low lows, and it doesn't really matter how well they're doing. At any time, that could fall off a cliff. Look at how super successful the Wii was, and then by the Wii U, their relevancy was gone. Kids didn't even know what a Nintendo... Ow, I hit my hand on the TV. I'm sorry. Sorry, I was gesturing really wildly. I hit my hand on the monitor. Kids didn't even know what a Wii U was for a while. So anyway, I'm kind of going around in circles here. Basically, it's awesome because they are in the position. I mean, like, any game company at this point. Any of them. They all do it. PlayStation's done it. They've done it before. Oh, you know what? We're doing great. All we got to do now is sit back and rake in the cash. You know, like anybody with it, like, especially because the Nintendo, they've done all the big hitters. They did the Zelda, they did the Mario, they did the Mario Kart, they did the Smash, they did the Splatoon, they did the Animal Crossing. Everything is perfect. They have plenty of titles. All of these titles will continue to sell for the life of the system. All they could not make another game on Switch and just sit back. The sales would keep coming in. The third parties would keep coming in. That eShop library would grow bigger and bigger and bigger. Nintendo's just making, you know, Switch Online memberships and everything. They're just raking in the money. They don't have to produce another piece of software for the next 3 years. All they gotta do is just keep driving the price down. You know, they wanna rejuvenate sales, you know, do a Switch Pro, or don't, just make it cheaper just to get the stragglers, you know? They'd still do great. And then when the next one comes around, just like, I don't know, do the same thing, but again, which is kind of a weird topic because I kind of want them to do that, but it's a whole thing I'll talk about it in a second. They basically don't need to do much at all. And yet, he's like, no. We're not gonna make that mistake again. We're not gonna pull a Wii. We're not gonna just stop making games and say, who cares? We're making all the money in the world, because that is very short-sighted. And I don't know, there are many areas where I criticize the company, obviously, but it's nice to just read one article, see one series of quotes, and just have one of those worries, one of those concerns just kinda put to rest. And it's not necessarily a guarantee. You know, just because Nintendo is aware of the fact that they could nosedive again. I just love that he said nosedive. He's just so, like, real about it. You know what I mean? He did not try to soften it. He's like, no. We will become irrelevant. We will nosedive if we're not careful. But just the fact that he knows that doesn't mean it won't happen. That's not necessarily armor against it happening. The Switch is a success. Nothing's going to change that. But for all we know, they really messed up the next one. And they do nosedive, and nobody cares about them again. And that does sort of lead me to the one slightly worrying thing about this, because I get the idea that a Switch 2 has to kind of wow people, at least in some way. But I have this big thing where I don't want the gimmicks anymore. I feel like the gimmicks just get in the way. So I don't really like them, and so he does mention that old Nintendo thing where we gotta keep giving people new stuff. Now, in terms of software, I say, yeah, new games. New, just better, cooler games. More innovative games. Yeah, absolutely. But then when it comes to hardware, if he's talking about creating new experiences, the Switch is perfect. I don't want a new experience. I don't want anything else. The Wii, the motion controls, that was a new experience, and I'm tired of it. I don't want it anymore. The Wii U, that was technically kind of new in a way, but I nothing is better than just the Switch. The new thing was being able to play on the TV and handheld. I don't want to complicate it more. So that's the only slight worry, is that he does mention that. We gotta surprise him. So does that mean, instead of being like, we gotta keep making good games, he's being like, we gotta make the Switch 2 really wacky. We gotta make it have some weird, crazy gimmick that gets people, I don't really know. That would be bad. That would be the opposite. It would be the opposite of all this stuff that I'm talking about right now, and I would not like that, but I'm not gonna come away with this being too worried. Overall, it's just awesome. It's awesome that he said all that stuff. It's awesome that he acknowledged it. It's awesome that Nintendo knows they are not magic. Just like one success, even a crazy wacky success. I mean, the Switch is even more successful than the Wii. The Wii was a sky high, wow, lightning in a bottle success. And the Switch is, it's even bigger. It's gonna sell more. It's healthier, more core gamers. More of that audience is gonna stick around for the next one. They are set up for success. Absolutely. And as long as Nintendo doesn't let that get to their heads, then they're probably golden. But what do you think? What do you think about all this? Are you gleaning the same thing? Are you appreciating this, all these quotes, as much as I am? Am I looking too far into this? Am I making a mountain out of a molehill, as Arlo's sometimes, maybe, every once in a while do? I don't know. Let me know down in the comments. And you have yourself a wonderful, beautiful, awesome, amazing sandwich? Plot twist.